हेलो, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल। सो आई थिंक यू आर जॉइनिंग वन बाय वन। सो दिस इज़ द सेशन। तो टुडे वी आर इन द थर्ड डे एंड दिस इज़ द मॉर्निंग सेशन। सो आई एम डॉक्टर सौरभ माइती, वर्किंग इन द मेरीन फिशरी एडवाइजरी सर्विस फ्रॉम इन इनकॉइस। सो इन कंटिन्यूएशन विथ माई फर्स्ट प्रेजेंटेशन in the morning session of the first day, that was about the marine fishery advisory service. So I'll continue further. So this is the topic. Actually today I'll be covering you mostly on the life cycle and how fisheries parameter, oceanographic parameters, environmental parameters are important for predictions. So again, with very good morning to you all, or some of the friends who are from the abroad, maybe good evening. Or so let me start the presentation. Thank you. So today I'll be talking about mostly about the advisory services. From where actually we are going to a little bit in the prediction side. So presently in INCOIS, whatever the advisory services we are providing, that is based on real-time advisory services. Means with the help of satellite actually or other technology, we are getting the parameters. And with the help of those parameters, we are trying to give advisories to the fishermen actually where will be the fish stock, which we are maintaining with some sustainable approach will be there so that over-exploitation issue will not be there. So now with the help of these oceanographic processes, how we are going to actually predict this fish stock today, I'll be talking about little bit in the deeper technical part. And with the real-time advisory services, with the help of these oceanographic processes, how we can predict the future, whether it is in the level of short term or in the in terms of long-term prediction also. So let me first give you a glimpse about earlier little bit. I have already talked about these things. This is about the fishery advisories with the help of prediction, with the help of some coastal or oceanographic processes. Now if we go in detail actually, so this is the fishing heritage of the fishermen. When a fisherman actually they are very well versed with this ocean actually. So in the sense means in the spatial as well as in the temporal scale, means they are very much aware. It is a traditional knowledge basically fishermen are using. So with the traditional knowledge they are aware that particularly which area will be more productive. So good catch where in a species level, which species will be available, which locations, and particularly if we are going in the seasonal scale also, seasonal or in a fortnight scale, in a lunar scale actually. So which time actually, which species will be available. So those things are there very much, it is well known to them. But the problem is that nowadays actually, with the dwindling stock, actually these traditional knowledges are sometimes not working. So that's where actually we are into the picture. So with the help of recent science and techniques, whether we can support this livelihood actually, this is the purpose of the goal. Now this is the purpose of this entire program. Now I will actually go for this fishing heritage. So some of you maybe seen these things. So people are actually using, fishermen are using basically where the birds are aggregating, the color of the ocean they are checking surface, then muddy and oily water, calm sea, reflection in the night, color to a kind of smell. Actually, these kind of practices are already available with the fishermen. Actually, if you know, one particular fisherman is seeing that, maybe he is calling their friends, or in the network circle people are going there, and they are catching the species fish. So now while we are putting science little bit here, so where actually potential ground will be there, with the help of satellite light techniques we can identify some of the oceanic fronts. Oceanic fronts means the gradient. Those who have missed the first class, so for them actually I'll give you a recap. So oceanic fronts, meandering patterns, eddies, rings, mushroom shaped features, tongue shaped features, coastal upwelling, self break fronts, plume fronts, diverging fronts, converging fronts. So a lot of fronts, a lot of features are there. So basically, if there are some techniques with the help of those, actually if we can identify those features, so it will be much easier to us and also the fishermen that actually where fish is aggregating. So coming to this remote sensing part, actually if with the help of sea surface temperature if we are having, then with the help of sea surface temperature and chlorophyll image, actually we can identify the sea surface temperature thermal fronts as well as chlorophyll plume. So that's in the right side of the panel you can see the chlorophyll plume, and in the left side of the panel it is showing the thermal feature using NOAA AVHRR. NOAA is a US satellite. So with the help of this AVHRR image, actually we can identify the thermal fronts. Thermal fronts are nothing but the gradients. So when from the sea surface temperature actually image we are checking, it's a gradient. So suppose there is an immediate drop in temperature in a after for particular reason. So if there is immediate drop or immediate rise in temperature, so those actually fronts we are very important to identify. So these thermal fronts are actually where fishes are aggregating. So thermal fronts we can identify. So in the thermal front region, your nutrients are coming from the down to the surface. Once your nutrients are coming to the surface, it is actually good, and temperature is also dropping in a particular locations in that region. Actually nutrients are available, so phytoplankton growth will be there. So that's why we are interested to identify those fronts. That is the reason behind it. So here you can see with the help of this schematic diagram, here I have given you the details from the schema. Actually you can get idea. So NOAA AVHRR and the METOP is in the right side, from where actually sea surface temperature will imagery we are getting, and upwelling boundary from that upwelling and bound we are identifying in the zones where actually nutrients will be more. If nutrients are more, then phytoplankton will be more. So phytoplanktons are more, that these are food for the species. Automatically fishes will be attracted in that particular region, and this ground will be potential for fishing. Now I have mentioned here from the perspective of the sea surface temperature, which is the parameter, physical parameter. Now if we are considering the biology, so if we are having a remote sensing satellite, suppose that this is the left side of the diagram, you can see OCM and MODIS. OCM is ocean color monitor. Presently in OCM series, India is having ocean color monitor 2 in picture, and OCM 2 and OCM 3 is in the pipeline. MODIS is a NASA satellite, and which is US based, and from there actually we can get the ocean color imagery. That means the chlorophyll concentration. Once we are having a ocean color imagery with the help of ocean color, actually we can identify the potential ground where phytoplankton will be more. Again, phytoplanktons are more and food. Now think, in a particular day if we are having sea surface temperature and good quality of ocean color monitor data, that means ocean color imagery, so we can overlap and upwelling boiling zones which are identified from the sea surface temperature images, we can cross verify whether these upwelling are really productive or not with the ocean color data. Now what happens actually if in a upwelling started now, so immediately there may not be the nutrients and may not be the phytoplankton growth. It takes, if it is a persistent feature, it takes for some time, and after that actually there will be a good growth of phytoplankton. So if upwellings are identified from the sea surface temperature image and that is persisting, that means winds are not vigorous, surface currents are not much more, so that they will be dissipated. So we have to track those upwelling zones and we have to cross verify with this ocean color image whether phytoplanktons are more. So this is the technique behind the potential fishing zone advisories. So here in the left side of the panel you can see the PFZ advisories based on the sea surface temperature image. The upper panel, upper image is from the sea surface temperature, and the down one is the chlorophyll. Now both sea surface temperature and chlorophyll, with the help of that we are identifying the fronts. Now once the fronts are identified and plumes are identified, in the right last panel actually in the top you can see the bold lines, those are the potential fishing zone advisories, and down if there is a tabular format, so in the table actually we are providing the informations those who are not able to interpret. So the upper panel, what it says, that bold lines are potential fishing zones, those are identified from the sea surface temperature. Now arrow, you can see these arrows are nothing but the surface current information. Fishermen, we continuously do the feedback survey from the fishermen, and fishermen express their interest on the sea surface current. So we have integrated surface current also with the potential fishing zone line, and the dotted lines are contour and the coastlines are there. So this is the major technique actually with which present advisories are going from inquest to the fisherman. So this is a real time advisory, so this is a real time advisory, this is not the predictions. So every day these type of advisories are generated and these advisories are passed to the fishermen for on regular and daily basis. Now I have talked about this real-time advisories. Now if we have to predict the stock for tomorrow, then how we will predict? So there the techniques will be little bit different. So here actually with the help of these oceanic parameters, how we can identify the ground, I have which predict the ground which may be the good ground for the fishery. So that one schema I have given, so it's a real-time advisory to the prediction. Here you can see the observations are much more important, because when you are going for a species level prediction systems, so the observations are hugely these observations are important. And this need to be always on regular basis. Observations are important, because these observations may be from the satellite, maybe in situ, and those in situ means these in situ observations are from not only from the fishery, so it need to be from the physical aspect, from the environmental aspect. So ocean all parameters need to be observed on regular basis. So with the help of these observations and fishery observations, not only the landing center data, or always landing center data are not much useful. So for that this purpose actually georeferenced fish catch data with the quantity, it is very much important. So once your observations are there, with the help of analysis, knowledge and intuitions, you can build a conceptual model. So with the help of this knowledge, the conceptual models are developed. So once these conceptual models have developed with the help of numerical and computational facility, you can actually develop a numerical modeling model actually. So numerical models are, once it is developed, so this is not only based on single parameters, so several parameters are important. So basically with the help of these numerical techniques, parameters are optimizations is very much important. So once these numerical models modeling you will run, so based on that, with the help of huge data sets, not only from the physicals are important, then biological data set. Physicals means in the case of fishery, if we think this is a salinity, temperature, oxygen, so other lot of parameters, maybe environmental parameters, rainfall, so then physical lot of other parameters are there, like mixed layer depth, thermal structure, so those things are very much important. So once this is with that, now which parameters are very much important for development of this model, these things are very much important. So we can give the weightage. So this is the parameters optimizations. Once these parameters are optimized, and you can develop multiple model with the help of these models, actually fitted model, actually we can give a best fit model. So then again, with the help of observations and validations, which model is working best, so that model you can consider. With the help of that model, actually prediction in the species level is possible. So then once these species level predictions are developed, again there is an independent observations is required to perform for the performance test, that is the validations and fine-tuning. So this is again a very much important. So once we are converting this real-time advisories, you can understand so how much complex it is. So it is actually prediction is not easy task actually, and for that had a rigorous and very focused species wise actually planning is required. So and it is a long term observations based on that numerical model is required. And once these predictions you want to make it, we want to make it actually operational, so that time again actually consider continuous observations need to be carried on, and it is day by day actually your model will be the first version, maybe whatever the accuracy level in the next version, with the again lot of more data you can upgrade your model. So this is a continuous focused work. So in a schema actually I tried to give you some descriptions, give you some brief about this how ocean features are important for her predictions of this type of fisheries model. So now I'll give you a little glimpse about this when particular species. So I'll be talking about in today's class and in the next class mostly on the two species. So what are the available literatures are there, and with the help of all literatures, with the help of available work in India or in abroad, so how and a model can be developed, so which can be used for regular predictions actually. So this is kind of a brief actually about the species level prediction system I'll try to mention. So I'll complete today's class with a species called Hilsa, which on which actually INQUAS is working now for more than 3 to 4 years. So with the and again one more species I'll be talking in my next class, that is the sardine, tomorrow morning session actually. With the help of that actually how one best prediction model can be developed for or operational purpose actually. As you all may be aware of, so distribution of HILSA, actually I have talked over here, so found in rivers and estuaries in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Burma and Persian Gulf area, where it can be found in the Tigris and Euphrates rivers in and around Iran and Iraq. So in India mostly it is Hooghly, so tributary of Ganges, Mahanadi, Chilka, Godavari, Tapti, Narmada. So basically India is available, HILSA is available mostly in the GBM Delta, popularly known as Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna deltaic region, which mostly India shared by India and Bangladesh. Also Myanmar is also having a good amount of this type of species also. So means the upper part of the northern part of the Bay of Bengal is a good habitat of this particular species. So totally yearly production is 5 millions, and 50 to 60% are caught by Bangladesh, 15 to 20% are caught by India and Pakistan, 5 to 10% are caught by Malaysia, Thailand, China, Vietnam and Sri Lanka. The fish contributes about 12% of the total fish production and about 1% of the GDP in Bangladesh. So these are general characteristics and the life cycle of a HILSA actually. So Tinualosa HILSA, popularly known as a HILSA sad, is a pelagic species in the Cleopidae family. So well distributed in the coastal and self estuaries also. So breeding migration highly dependent on a freshwater discharge and a phytoplankton mostly. From the gut content data, it has been observed that diatoms are predominant in this particular species. So it's an anadromous kind of species. That means it is a urehaline species basically, breeding highly dependent on southwest monsoon. Here you can see in the right panel. So the juvenile fish are known as jhatka. So the downward is seawater. The adult premature fish from the seawater, it's comes in the adult fish goes to towards the brackish water, and crossing the brackish water, it goes to the fresh water in the upstream of the river. And in India, it has been reported that before Farakka barrage also, it was available up to Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh also. So now for the spawning, it migrates towards the upper ocean. So now due to this anthropogenic impact, the actually the most of the species are in the downstream only. So there are a lot of spawning grounds available in the Hooghly River in the Indian part also. So once the spawning is done in the fresh water, so again the jhatka, which is the juvenile species, spend time there in the fresh water up to the juvenile species when this come back to the brackish water, and again it pass to the sea water to the adult for it migrates again to the sea. So now India is having for the conservation of this particular species, actually Indian government in the specific very precisely West Bengal government has declared some of the portions of the sanctuaries in Indian Sundarban. So and this is the area in the Matla, Thakuran, Rai Mangal, which is at the in the border of the Bangladesh, and in the Kagdeep, Namkhana area, Fraser Ganj area, Diamond Harbor area, there are a few spawning grounds are there. So those are declared not on a continuous basis, in a temporal scale, actually particular time it of the year it is declared as a sanctuary, so that fishing can be banned for the when this spawning occurs. Now if particularly sorry, so particularly if we are going for this particular species, so this is a kind of a species which is anadromous in nature. So I'll give you the brief about the salinity adaptations of the species. So here the marine fish, so which drinks large quantity of water, secretes salt. through special cells, small volume of highly concentrated urine. This is the typical actually example of a marine fish. So and freshwater fish, so do not drink much water. They shall absorb salt and large volume of dilute urine. Actually they passes. So now when we this marine fish, and we can distinct it, this marine fish and freshwater. Now we, if we are talking about this kind of species which is anadromous in nature, so they have the capacity to adapt in the freshwater also and marine water also. So that means they can modify themselves according to the time when they goes for breeding migration towards the fresh water. They change their body structure and not structure, the they change their habitat. That time actually they can adapt in the fresh water, and other time when they thrive in the sea water, the marine the structure body will be accustomed with the marine environment. So basically if we are going to the characteristics of that particular species, so it's it is actually we can differentiate. It's a stenothermal, urethermal, stenohaline, urehaline. Stenothermal means actually which is there are different kind of species. So they cannot actually thermal, stenothermal, that means actually the wide range of a thermal difference they cannot adopt. However, urethermal is opposite to that. That means it's a big temperature gradient it can and sustain. So stenohaline, it's a in the perspective of salinity. So stenohaline means they cannot actually thrive in a broad spectrum of salinity difference. However, urehaline can sustain in a bigger difference of salinity. So the species which we are talking about today is haline, anadromous in nature. Now I'll come to the status of that particular species Hilsa. So here I have given not only the West Bengal, I have tried to give you a glimpse about the condition of the stock in the West Bengal also. Here you can see from the 2002 to 2014, I have given the total landings of this particular species here, different kind of this species actually different year the landings are different. So why this type of differences are coming, that is the important aspect actually to understand. So however, there is a 2010 abnormal year which having a huge amount of fish catch. So that that event was particular, and there some reasons are behind also. So we will not talk much about this 2010 abnormality in this particular lecture. So this is the status. Within the time span of the 8 years, the condition factors has decreased nearly about 45%. That is, the health condition of the fish is deteriorating very fast in its natural habitat. B value represents the natural nature of the growth of a fish. A value of 3 refers an allometric growth, and allometric growth, you all know that this is the growth type where actually which is not uniform with the body size and the body width. So B value of the Hilsa reduced to 39% during this time span. So when we look into the data in the down part also, so there is annual fish catch of Hilsa is given here. So however, it shows that the Hilsa landings has been increased significantly in Bangladesh portion. Now this is some of the slides I'll share you with this with the this is collected in collaborations with partner agencies in INCOIS to understand the distribution pattern in the season wise. Here the two crops are there. Here you can see that the left one is from the winter months, and the right one in the summer month. So during winter month, mostly the species is staying in the coast, near coastal, or away from the coast. And towards this winter, there is summer, actually there is a tendency towards migrating towards the coast. And during the next slide here, it is monsoon and the post monsoon. The left one is from the monsoon. The monsoon is the June, July, August, September is very important for this species. So this species actually comes towards the coast for breeding. So these migrations, actually fishermen use these migrations when you use this window to catch this fish. However, sake of this conservation, there is a breeding. So breeding time, based on the conservation, there is a fishing ban. So that is from the March, that is from 61 days bans are there. 15th April onwards, there is a ban. So, and the right side of the panel, it is post monsoon. So here again you can see the landings are not that much prominent, however the fish is abundant in the area. This is the CPV. In the perspective of CPV, monsoon is there in the 18.92 monsoon time, that is average CPV, catch per unit effort. So kg, if the unit is kg per hour. And the post monsoon months, 13 to 25, summer it is again very low, and winter again 2.31 CPV from the observations what we did with the help of this fisherman boat. So it shows this kind of data. So the regular sampling for understanding of the species, actually regular sampling is very much important. So we have perform regular sampling. We have existing laboratory setup over there. So here you can see the CTD operations are on. From the CTD operation, not only CTD, other sensors are there. Chlorophyll sensors, then turbidity sensors, then we collect the biological samples also, phytoplankton dynamic, this information dynamics, how the which time of the year, actually which kind of phytoplankton species are more, what is the nutrient structure. So those type of informations are collected to understand the parameters. So here I'll give you some of the plots actually, which are done with the help of Partners Institute. So here June, July, August, September, it is the background is the salinity. With the, you can see this June onwards, there is a tendency towards migration towards the coast, towards the low saline area. Where actually low saline area, this species migrates towards that. July also the trend is going towards up, and August also towards the estuary, and in the September in the estuary region, and in the September also you can see that inside the estuary also species are available. So as the monsoon intensifies from June to September, it leads to the salinity depletions, leading hilsa to migrate towards the river. As high resolution coastal salinity data from the satellite as well as model salinity is unable predictions of the monsoon is very much essential. Now I'll be talking about the river discharge. River discharge is having a huge important from this graph. It is important. This is the zone where the river discharge data are very classified. However, we'll able to collect some of the data from the published literature. From 2009 to 2014, you can see the river discharge, when it increase, it is having a direct impact on the species towards migration towards the coast. So in the month of August, when river discharge are more, so that time actually the species migration towards the coast are also more. So there are some plotting here I have tried to show you. This is based with the help of rainfall and the HILSA CPV. So rainfall, when it is, the spikes are there, with which actually this is the landing of the particular species is directly linked. So here these data are not the landing from the landing data. This is from the observations, primary observations, which we collected with the help of a local academia. So here the plottings are also 2013 to 15. Here in the rainfall is having direct relation so with the species availability. Now this is a publications done by Hussain et al. In 2020, where they are also showing that nutrient is directly having relations with the phytoplanktons. So with the phytoplanktons, once the phytoplanktons, that means here the silicate is much more important. Silica is having a direct relations with the diatom growth. So once these diatoms are available, that is a very important actually. If diatoms are available, then it is the food of this fish, and this growth of the fish is also important. In the further slides, I'll little bit talk about this, how this phytoplankton is important in different part of the life cycle of that life cycle of this particular species. So here again, chlorophyll, if in that particular area, we can see June, July, August, post October, November, there is a increase in phytoplankton, which is also actually in the down also, you can see the zooplankton graph, that is January to February, March, April, how January onwards, January to February, there is a drop. Again, after November, December, there is an increase. So if you tally this phytoplankton with this zooplankton concentration in that particular area, so you can see that phytoplanktons in the winter also it is high, which actually supports the zooplankton. However, HILSA catch and the phytoplanktons are having direct relations also in these publications also. Hussain et al., they have mentioned. So now during the monsoon, higher nutrient but lower the phytoplankton mass, biomass, light limitations due to cloud cover. High nutrient load during monsoon leads to the high phytoplankton biomass during post monsoon. High silicate value during monsoon enhance the growth of diatom, as the diatom are having siliceous structure. Gut content and phytoplankton data also we have checked. Now here interestingly you can see that this blue graph is a organic blue line is for the organic debris. Now the red lines are for diatoms. Now blue lines here you can see the organic debris is increasing during this monsoon time, and it is going down during this winter time. However, this diatom are showing just opposite in nature. We have checked actually that during this June, July, August, September, the diatoms are less in this very negligible amount of diatoms are available in the gut of the fish. Now this if we are plotting this diatom versus dinoflagellate in the month wise, so in the June onward, diatoms are all every time diatoms are predominant in that particular area of this Indian part of northern Bay of Bengal, and dinoflagellates, however, dinoflagellates are very less in number during this winter time. During monsoon, brooder fish are gradually decreasing phytoplankton intake. That may be the phytoplanktons are less in that area. However, sand organic debris intake increases. October onwards, diatom intake increases, and sand or organic debris intake get lows. percentage of occurrence of diatom increasing from post monsoon, from monsoon to post monsoon, species diversity of diatom also increasing during post monsoon. Now if with the in a life cycle if we are checking the importance of phytoplankton, so and so you can see there is a from the brackish water towards marine water, then fresh water. If that brackish water part, actually phytoplankton chlorophyll is important for growth and nourishment of this species. However, when they are migrating from adult fish from sea to this fresh water for breeding, how much phytoplankton important for adult during breeding migration, that is again a question, because in their gut phytoplankton concentrations are very much low during this breeding migrations. However, for the larval growth, actually these phytoplankton's abundance are very much important. Now we have plotted some of the georeference fish catch data with the wind, because we got a hints from that of fishermen that they follow the wind directions with the wind directions towards the coast, and during the coast actually when the wind directions are there, so that direction filsa actually comes towards the coast with the wind. Here I have tried to plot some of the outcome. Now whether cyclone induced increased fish catch, so this is the slide where actually you can see the upper panel is giving the impact of phylene. It is in the October of 2013, the Bay of Bengal, actually the cyclones are in prone, the Bay of Bengal is very prone to cyclone. Now during the phylene, actually we have seen that fish catch also increased, all fish catch also increased, then induced hilsa catch also increased. What happens during this cyclone, you must aware that nutrient entrainment of nutrient comes towards the surface. So if their entrainments are more after, once the cloud cover after the cyclones are moved, then actually lights also available. So with this entrainment of this nutrient, actually so fish catch will be, phytoplankton bloom will be more. So once phytoplankton blooms are more, then fish catch will be more. So during this phylene, the river runoffs are also more, and also entrainments are more. This coincide, and the nutrient enrichments are there. After that, actually phytoplanktons, there is a huge abundance in that area, so that phytoplanktons with the enrichment of this phytoplankton, again this hilsa catch as well as other pelagic species catch also increased. Now primary productivity, yesterday you might have seen gone through a presentations of primary productivity, so how much it is important for this prediction of marine fishery also. So this is having a direct linkages are there, and with the help of if the primary productivity has more, then it is actually directly impacting the hilsa abundance also. So primary productivity is also a major parameter which need to be taken in account during this parameterization. Now I'll just brief here about what is the outcome of this. These are nice publications came from Hoshin et al. During 2020. So most of the things has been described here. So I'll genetically similar population, Bangladesh, India and Myanmar. So then spawning, migration to fresh water, not necessarily to the natal region, spawning migration to fresh water during this monsoon time, and spawning in river or estuary during October. This is a secondary spawning also, it is noticed, and spent migration towards sea during November to December, and fry juvenile nursing in river estuary during this December to March, and juvenile start seawards migration during April, adult mature at sea June, July, then start upstream migration. Inadequate data on offshore and high sea migration, that's why abundance of fishing potential in the offshore, that is not much explored. This is really lagging in this this Hilsa study also in Bangladesh and India both. So if we jot down all together, so what are the major challenges? What are the major challenges actually? So highly commercial value and over harvested species, highly migratory and anadromous species, mostly targeted during monsoon when stock is near to coast or estuary for breeding, high interannual variability, prediction need to be developed in quantitative approach and should be sustainable in nature. So if we particularly see how much important this chlorophyll and other parameters during the life phase of this particular species, then we will see the chlorophyll or phytoplankton is important for growth and nourishment in sea and estuary both. So, but the phytoplankton has a limited impact, maybe it has a limited impact in the adult fish from when actually they are migrating towards the estuary for spawning. But a salinity depletion due to monsoon, wind directions have strong impact. Chlorophyll is very much important, chlorophyll or phytoplankton is very much important during the larval rearing, as the species mostly preferred by this particular species is diatom, then diatom availability is much more important for larval rearing as well as successful recruitment. Then in situ observations are important for monitoring the spawning and rearing ground. Here I have also mentioned that in the earlier slide that salinity is having a huge impact on this drop in salinity, having a huge impact in the migration. And again, wind is also having a good impact in this migration. Phytoplankton availability is important. Lunar phase, it is observed that waxing gibbous or waning crescent time, actually this is the most that time Hilsa availability is much in the fishing ground. So what will be the proposed services? So the proposed services may be the short term or long term prediction with which actually we can manage the stock, not only for harvesting, for the managing also. The spawning ground need to be identified, and the advisory is not need to be given in the spawning ground. We need to be forced to move towards the away from the coast. So those type of informations are important. Some of the area need to be identified as a no fishing zone during the spawning ground also, though there is a declarations in sanctuary by the local authorities, but need to be strictly followed. So I'll give you a experimental just a setup how these advisories can look actually. So how this typical advice. So now if we are going for a particular habitat suitability modeling approach, there are several techniques, several numerical modeling approaches are there with which we can generate a idea where to go for fishing, whether high, medium, low availability will be there, which area not need to be seized. So those kind of informations are very much important. So small pelagic fish habitat suitability model, here we have used this one particular species there which will be shortly operational. So generalized additive model we have used, it is a GAM. So this is the parameters are used in ROMS based parameters, and also ROMS is a model from which not only ROMS, other parameter, other from physical and bio physical and merged models are available. So from where actually chlorophyll concentration, dissolved oxygen, salinity data can be used, and remote sense, remotely sensed rainfall and chlorophyll fish catch, all data can be used as input. So best fit model, I have given a small equations here. So CPV can be estimated. So in the right side of the panel, you can see actually there I have given two sample output how it can look. So sample one here, how high to low this gridded and dotted also we can. This is not the final, to give you some output, some idea about the how it can look. So this type of approach can be adopted towards development of this type of habitat suitability map to predict the species. This is not only actually one kind of species, for another species, any species actually this can be adopted. Thank you. I have given some of the glimpses. In the next class also I will actually go through another species. So I'll just go through some of the questions. There is a question: what is the scientific name of the Hilsa species? This is the Tinuolosa ilisa. Does monsoon cycle affect? The next question is from does monsoon cycle affect the fish availability, as India is getting two monsoon? Yes, obviously monsoon cycle effect, as this is anadromous kind of species, so southwest monsoon is very much important for prediction. Informations related to southeast monsoon is very much important, summer monsoon. However, during this winter monsoon, upper Bay of Bengal is not much impacted, so that time rainfall may not be very useful as a parameter. But during the summer monsoon, it is very much important, because with the summer monsoon, actually the salinity in the estuary as well as upper in the ocean, actually near the coast also, it depletes. So it actually helps fish this species to spawn in the coast as well as estuary region. Because what happened, this, as it is anadromous in nature, so anadromous in nature, it actually prefers to go towards coast or estuary for breeding. So that the body changes happened. So as I have given a slide that urehaline in nature. So it is urehaline in nature. So from marine water after April actually it migrates towards the upper ocean, and that time onwards they changes the adopt themselves like that, so that from marine water towards fresh water they can actually change the body accordingly and adopt there for spawning. Here I will just again repeat what are the important things. So generally the spawn in river estuary during the second point onwards, you can see this spawning migration to fresh water, not necessarily to the natal region. It is actually very much predominant in this particular species. So during this monsoon time, summer monsoon, April onwards, so spawn in river estuary, they have a tendency, that some ecotypes having a tendency to spawn in There are controversies, maybe the genetically similar populations, but ecotypes may be different. So some of the ecotypes are very local in the estuary region. They spawn in the October to November time only. Then spent migration again starts after spawning during the November to December. It comes again towards the ocean. Fry juvenile nursing in river or estuary during December to March. Juvenile starts seaward migration in April, and adult mature at sea in June to July, then start upstream migration. Upstream June, July onwards, this migration starts. Inadequate data of the offshore. This is important. Basically, we have no data on the offshore. So coastal, near coastal, and few off of the up to which location fishermen are going for fishing, up to that locations only fishing data are available. So analysis are mostly done in that region only. So mostly up to 50 to 100 meter bathymetry. So this is all about today's presentations. I'll again check if any questions are there further. So do every species have different advisories? Yeah, we are planning for every different kind of advisories for every species. So this is the glimpse I have given about for this Hilsa species. I'll again give another details about the research about the sardine in the next class. And is there any impact on Hilsa fishery due to climate change? Huge impact is there, not only climate change. So immediate anthropogenic impact also there. So this species is dwindling like anything, and the stock is actually going down. So just two questions: what are the parameters taking out for the prediction in one type of fisheries by using numerical model? So as of now, we are exploring different parameters, but based on the weightage, actually we are checking which parameters will work, not only for all time of the year. So maybe different models will be there in different season. So presently what we are using is sea surface temperature, then chlorophyll, then salinity, then dissolved oxygen, then the wind, phytoplankton abundance, lunar cycle, then also other parameters one by one we are in planning to incorporate. So this is the study going on, and we are expecting to make it operational very soon, as the validation presently it is going on. So is there any impact of how natural calamities affect the prediction? Natural calamities affect the predictions, not only this type of species level advisories, for also our primary advisory, that is the potential fishing zone. Suppose in the during this natural calamities, during cyclone or during a storm, actually mostly cloud covers are there. We are highly dependent on chlorophyll value, so that is taken from satellite. So real-time satellite data we are unable to get because of these cloud covers. So this is a major problem during the natural calamities. Predictions are affected. However, we can get the scope, we can take it as a scope also, as I have shown you one on a slide, that how we can predict this. There is an impact of cyclone in fisheries, in normal fish species, as well as species like Hilsa. So that is actually directly giving you that after the cyclone, the all species will be available that will increase. It will automatically increase because there is a tendency we have seen that immediately after when the cyclone is ending, there is a tendency that fishermen migrates towards the, it is very much prominent in Bay of Bengal, so in the northern part of the Bay of Bengal in Odisha and West Bengal, they prefer to go for fishing immediately after the cyclone, because it is their traditional knowledge from that time onwards. Earlier all was that once the cyclones are over, after within 1 to 2 days there will be a huge amount of species available in the zone. So that's why actually cyclone is in one sense impacting the prediction, and cyclone is also a post cyclone there, as the fish species will be more, so that is, we can explore it as a opportunity and give advisories also. So best fit model are all parameter is from forecast, or some of them are observed. Yes, best fit models are some of them observed, as well as we are using merged products. Merged product means not only from the satellite, not only from the models, satellites, and these observations also. So this is from the ongoing observations also. Does any Indian satellite is being used for study? Is example the way NOAA, which is US based? Yes, in the next class I'll be giving you an idea about this, how NOAA is forecasting, because in India Ministry of Earth Science is collaborated with NOAA. We have a MOU with them. So last 4 to 5 years we have worked, and we are trying to develop a operational prediction system for sardine. I'll share some of the slides actually, how NOAA is doing and how NOAA and Indian government both actually doing towards operational forecasting. So some of the slides maybe I'll share in the next presentation. So by popular, there is a question, does the Hilsa sad catch is affected by pollutions? Highly affected by pollutions. So we have seen during this COVID time also, post COVID, the parameters which we are using or commonly used by India or any other countries, those who are involved in this type of prediction, so that are during this COVID time, we have seen that there is a huge improvement in the parameters. So once the parameters are in good, so good shape, actually obviously there will be a impact in the Hilsa abundance also. So pollution is directly impacting Hilsa set. Is there collaborations between diatoms abundance and organic debris concentrations? Thank you. Yes, if you go one of our slide actually, so this is actually opposite as per the, is this presentation is what I am saying, so organic debris and the diatom, so this red line is for the diatom concentrations. So during this diatom concentrations, when during June, July, August, September, up to October, we have seen there is a depletion, means gradually it is decreasing. However, that the particular that window actually organic debris concentration is increasing. So this is opposite, means from the gut content analysis we have checked that diatoms availability are less during this monsoon time, however the organic debris are more during this monsoon time, and this winter time it is again opposite, diatom these organic debris are going low and these diatoms are increasing. I hope most of the questions what I got from my colleague, so what you have asked in the live session, so I am able to answer it. However, keep posting your questions. So maybe in the next class, or if not possible in the next class, during the course of time, actually in the comment box itself, we will answer it. Thank you very much. Let us close this session today, and we'll be joining again at 3 o'clock in the afternoon session, and tomorrow I'll be joining again at 10:30. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining with us. Stay tuned with InQuest channel.